I stay here. I for a long time, not so much this last year, but I would make 9, 10 trips to LA every year. Because I would be doing commercials one kind or another. And I always stayed in the same room. 9, 10, 10, 10, or 11, 10, which are virtually identical. You'd be hard pressed if you didn't know you were 9, 10 as opposed to 10, 10, or 11, 10 to know that you were in a different room. I mean, I'm a creature of habit, so I always stay in the same hotel in New York, same hotel in London, same hotel in LA. And maybe I just don't like change.
Do you like Los Angeles?
It's not whether I like it or I don't like it. If someone told me that I could never come back to LA, I would be very, very sad. I would have to cry myself to sleep at night. But if someone told me I could never leave LA, that might have a similar effect.
So what do you like in LA?
I like LA. It's a fine place to go and work. I've twice tried to live here, not so successfully. I bought a house, sold the house. Maybe I'm just a creature of Cambridge, Massachusetts. I don't even know anymore. It has been a relatively good place for myself and my family.
Yeah. Do you like it culturally? Do you participate in that way, or you're busy working?
Not really. I mean, my wife is always annoyed. They made me a member of the American Academy, and they keep inviting me to do this or to do that. I never really go there. I sometimes describe Cambridge as a city just filled with very smart people who have no desire to have anything to do with you. And that's more or less true. I have a lovely office. I have great people working with me. I have access to all of these research libraries in the area. I live about a mile from Harvard, and my office is towards Kendall Square. It's very, very close to MIT. So it's very much a university town. Probably the easiest way to describe it. And the other attractive detail that I always mention is there are only two cities in the United States where in the 2000 election, Bush came in third behind Gore and Nader, a distant third. And those two cities were Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Berkeley, California. So there you go.
Proud moments.
It's not America. I keep telling myself, where am I? I must be somewhere. It's Massachusetts, so it has to be, properly speaking, America. But it's not America. Whatever America is, I don't know what America is anymore.
Did you used to? Did you used to feel like you had a handle on it?
Certainly a lot more than I have today. Today, I just don't know. Yeah. Head shaking time, you know?
Well, it's hard to, I keep on thinking that the transitional, the thing that's amazing about all of it is that the rules just don't exist. And so people who are, you know, after a year, I'm 50, you're a little older than me, but I mean, after going through a lifetime of understanding how the system is and how people react to one another and what the politics of it all are, to have it all just kind of become irrelevant and in such an kind of ugly way is, I think, just leaves us all in shock. There's no answer, it seems like.
I think that's absolutely true. I would say that I'm in shock. It's the feeling of disorientation, destabilization. What's important to people? What does the country stand for? What should I be doing in the face of all of what's going on? I started writing for the New York Times again. But even that, I wonder, what do I hope to achieve? It's not as though people are influenced by rational argument. Seems to be a time of deep irrationalism. As if somehow rational argument doesn't matter anymore. And that is the most frightening thought of all. I mean, look, I've been around for a while, and you know that politics is deeply irrational at its heart. Maybe it was a delusion of thinking that it was more rational than it is, or that more people share the values that I have. I don't even know what to say. I'm speechless. The Times, I wrote two pieces, and I have a third coming up, that are about issues important to me. One is about the death penalty and the travel ban. Another was about command influence, Bo Bergdahl, and Trump's repeated threats that he would have him executed. And now a piece about the frozen trucker. This is a case involving Neil Gorsuch. Mm-hmm. During the summer of the campaign, the decision that he made on the 10th Circuit. But I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what you're supposed to do. I suppose you're just supposed to do something, but whether it will have any influence or any effect, you just don't know anymore.
Yeah, it feels a little like a Godzilla movie. Like something, because something has to happen. That isn't just a human activity to get rid of Godzilla. It has to leave for some reason that has nothing to do with us. We don't have control over it. All our little airplanes are meaningless. Shooting at it.
It's an interesting way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Well, there's
I do believe in Americans, though. I mean, I think if you look statistically, if you look at polling and everything, they do believe, people in America really do believe in things that Trump does not, and that Trump has just trying to eradicate. And we're seeing that with the healthcare situation, I think. I mean, I don't think America is as heartless and as hateful as our leadership at the moment. And that gives me some sort of false hope, probably, but hope nonetheless.
Well, you know what they say, false hope springs eternal.
So I guess amongst all of this insanity, Elsa is kind of a pleasant distraction from everything else.
A palate cleanser. Mm. It's an odd way of putting it. The movie that I'm very glad to have made. I really am. Maybe I would like the movie to be a little bit better. But I'm very, very glad I've made it. And I'm really glad that Elsa loves the movie.
I heard from the folks that who were putting it out that she has seen it many, many times, and she likes to see it with audiences. And
she goes to every screening, absolutely faithfully, and really enjoys every screening. Sees new things in the movie that she hadn't noticed before. I can't even imagine what it's like for her, because for years she really was passed over. She was the proverbial B-side, the person who's rejected, who doesn't get the attention that she deserves. Under, and maybe even unappreciated. But she is a great photographer. And I've felt this for years. There's a strange phenomenon. I was thinking about this recently. Say you believe something and no one else believes it. I encountered this when I first met Randall Adams, who is the protagonist of The Thin Blue Line, who was sentenced to death for a crime he did not commit. When I first met him, he's talking to me, telling me the details of the crime. Not the crime he committed, but the crime that he was convicted of. So what happens to you if you're telling a story? You know you're innocent, you believe you're innocent, but you also know that everybody around you thinks you're guilty. So you tell the story, and after a while, you lose heart. I don't know how better to describe it. When he first talked to me, it had this sing-song quality, as if he was going through a recitation of some legend or fable that had been told to him long ago, that he was no longer emotionally connected to the narrative. He was going through a kind of routine, performance art. I don't even know how to describe it. Did he even believe it anymore? And I wonder what happens if you're a really great artist and you ply your trade, you go to work every day, you create new art every day, but people really don't acknowledge it. Well, Elsa's never had the problem that she goes around telling people how great she is. She's exactly the opposite. She doesn't do anything of the sort. She does what she does, unpretentiously. I could never be as unpretentious as Elsa. That's never going to happen. I could just give it up now. Would I like to be as unpretentious as Elsa? Sure. Yeah. So many lessons to be learned from that woman. I'm a person who tries really, really hard to look smart. I mean, it's a value of mine. I want to look smart. So I try to say smart things. I try to use smart words. And a lot of my whole personal identity is invested in looking smart, maybe even being smart on occasion. And Elsa isn't involved with any of that. Mm. She really isn't. She's effortlessly profound, incredibly funny, hardworking, And a really, really good friend. I don't even know how better to put it.
When did you first get acknowledgement or whatever for being smart or the idea of being smart? I mean, was this a childhood thing that developed with you, or was it professional, or?
I imagine it's the result of having a lot of trouble in school, of having a lot of teachers dislike me, of getting expelled, not just once, but many times. And so there's part of you that takes over and you say, well, whoa, wait a second, I really am smart, you know?
Were you expelled for being too much of a smart aleck, or were there behavioral issues, or?
I like the idea, I like the category of behavioral issues. Yeah.
Nice broad swath.
Yeah.
But you weren't like intellectually wrestling with them to the point where they got angry at you and kicked you out of school? Or were you? I can see you doing that.
I don't even know anymore. My son, when he was 4 years old, looked at me and said, Dad, don't you know it? I'm an annoyifier. And I think I was an annoyifier from a very early age. Mm. And a proud family of annoyifiers.
So when did you first get something good coming out of being an annoyifier?
I started making films. And the first film, which was very, very difficult to make, turned out to be okay. In this sense, there were some people who really liked it. There are some people who didn't like it, but that's going to always be the case. All you need is just a couple of people who say, this is something great, this is something unusual, this is something special. So when Gates of Heaven came out, it went to the New York Film Festival. There was a newspaper strike that year, so no one wrote about it. No one wrote about the movie. And I thought, well, that's it. You know, it's going to vanish. Poof. And then for whatever reason, these two Chicago critics out of nowhere picked it up and started reviewing it on television again and again and again. That one year, the year that it came out, there were four separate reviews of Gates of Heaven by Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel. They kind of went crazy over it, both of them. It wasn't a thumbs up, thumbs down situation. They got into arguments about who liked the film more. I think it's a greater film than you think it is. Those kinds of arguments. But for years, I didn't have a shot. I made two films, Gates of Heaven and Vernon, Florida, and then no one would give me money to work.
Sorry, let me just step backwards, though. When you did Gates of Heaven, did you feel like you were fulfilling your vision fully? Did it feel like I have found my place in the world? This is the thing I should be doing. This is my voice?
No. I felt I wanted to make more films, but since people weren't giving me money to make more films, mm-hmm. Filmmaking, certainly in those days, when you were running film negative through a camera, was a costly enterprise. You couldn't just retreat to your garret apartment with a pad of paper and a pencil and write the great American novel. Documentary was unheard of. No one would ever think in a million years of putting a documentary in a theater, treating it like a feature film, a film that could have a potential theatrical run where people actually went to see it. That was unheard of. There was no independent film movement. There was no independent film.
Right.
There was nothing. And I found myself unemployed and eventually went to work as a private detective because that was the only work that I could find. So it's been difficult.
Were you a good private detective?
I was a very good private detective.
You kind of fits your business.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
You're getting people to talk to you and to give up information. You're reading through files. The only difference I can really think about is, well, there are a number of differences. I should be a little bit more ingenuous here. But really, you don't have a camera and you do have a camera.
Mm-hmm.
But I had no film career. I kept trying to make films. My wife says that many of the ideas that I had, their entire television channels devoted to those ideas, but no one would come near them. I would write endless proposals. The only act in town was public broadcasting.
Mm-hmm.
And one proposal after another, after another, after another, after another, rejected. And at a certain point, I just said, well, I'm not going to write a proposal for something that interests me. I'll just write something. I'll write a bullshit proposal which will interest them. That had a kind of academic pretense. I wrote a proposal about investigating predictions of future dangerousness, future violence. And I would interview this infamous Dallas psychiatrist known as Dr. Death. And they gave me the money to do that.
Mm.
And that was the beginning of the Thin Blue Line. Because Dr. Death, Dr. Grigson, suggested that I start interviewing death row inmates, people he had put on death row. And that brought me to Randall Adams and to David Harris and to the Thin Blue Line.
Mm. How did that work with PBS? Do they fund the Thin Blue Line at all, or did you deliver one thing and then continue on?
It was American Playhouse. It was Lindsay Law. Without him and Suzanne Weil, who was then head of PBS programming, mm-hmm. it would never have gotten made. It almost didn't get made, even with them. It's hard. So I identify with the B-side, because I was the B-side. Maybe I still am the B-side. Who am I kidding?
Well, did you feel when Thin Blue Line got the acceptance that it got, did you feel like you were on the A-side, or were you wary of it, or were you?
No, I felt I was much closer to the A-side. All of a sudden, you know, I had created something that people really liked. I'd done something.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always been the feeling that somehow I've left my best stories behind. They either haven't been turned into movies, or they were turned into movies in such a way that I, in the end, didn't really capture what was of interest to me. The Thin Blue Line, I still would very much like to tell the story of how I investigated this murder. Because whatever you want to say about the movie, the investigation was better. It was one of the best investigations that I know about. And it's a pretty amazing investigation. I pulled it off. Mm. How many times do you get a chance to do something like that? I actually pulled it off. And I'm not sure that anyone else could have done it. It involved too many moving parts, weird moving parts. The ability to interview people, the obsessiveness, the willingness to try and do anything, the fact that I followed the killer around for a year at enormous risk to myself. So I'm really proud of it, I think. How often do you get a chance to do something like that? You don't. And the pieces miraculously fit together. It's interesting when you look back. I'm obsessed with investigations. How many of them you can bring to some kind of conclusion. You can say, okay, I have a definitive answer here. I can tell you this is what really happened, or this is what really didn't happen. Mm-hmm. This is who committed the crime. This is who didn't commit the crime. And the Thin Blue Line, I can do that. I can do that feeling pretty damn confident that I know the answers. But I've been involved in all kinds of investigations which are much murkier, stranger, much harder to pin down.
Though you seem to like that. I mean, you're not none of your films really have the Perry Mason moment of the, you know, confession of, okay, I did it, you know, this is the answer.
I don't think there are Perry Mason moments in the real world. I wrote a whole book about this Jeffrey McDonald murder case, Wilderness of Error. And there's this overwhelming temptation. You feel it. You feel this pressure. As a writer, as a filmmaker, as an investigator, whatever, to force a conclusion. And then looking at the evidence, trying to be as scrupulous as possible, trying to force yourself to say, does this point in this direction or does it point in that direction? Is it inconclusive? I've been just today and yesterday talking with my researcher. I'm supposed to do another book. I have a book coming out from UChicago Press at the end of this year. I'm supposed to do another book for Penguin on the subject murderers I have known, the various murderers that I have known over the years. And they're a fair number. And I may put it on hold. I have several projects that interest me at the moment. One on Albert Speer, the head of armaments for the Third Reich, Hitler's architect, and another on Napoleon. Mm-hmm. They're oddball projects because they're not your traditional Hollywood biopic. They're obsessive and they're usually, for me, linked with an investigation. I want to go on with it all, you know. Mm-hmm.
Well, those two are kind of the most, have been like the weird track for a lot of people, a lot of artists over a lot of years. And nobody's really kind of gotten to the Napoleon that they wanted to get to. There are so many filmmakers who have the story of, you know, wanting to go down the Napoleon track and not ever even getting shooting or doing anything, including obviously Kubrick. And then the Spear thing, that was kind of a craze for a while about 20 years ago. There were three or four projects.
Yes.
And none of them were great. They were all kind of close, but not really.
No, I would agree. And the trick is, of course, if there is a trick, is you're not really making a movie about Napoleon. You're not really making a movie about Speer. You're doing something different. If it's just a biographical chronicle, I think to myself, why do it? But Napoleon and Speer were involved in enterprises very close to my heart. Napoleon, when he found himself in exile on St. Helena, started to re-examine his life. What had it meant? What actually had he done? Was he a good man or a bad man? It's revisiting the past by the central figure in the story, and his attempts to grapple with the meaning of the past is what makes it very powerful to me. Same is certainly true of Speer, because Speer found himself as a relatively young man in his 40s in the dock at Nuremberg, lucky to escape with his life. His subordinate was hung. And he too, revisiting his past, revisiting the Third Reich in an attempt to it's a mixture. It's not just simply to understand. It's a part, an attempt to efface his role, or to rewrite history, or to recreate history. I have this expression, I think it's more or less true, that the study of history is the study of the effacement of history, of people's attempts to obliterate it, to change it, to disguise it. So these are two stories about that, and I think they're very different from Brand X.
Well, it's funny because I think the conversation before about the current administration in the White House, after now 6 months of this, it's occurring to me that we really won't, all these peripheral characters, there is no Speer yet. There's no clearer Speer yet. But it's like 10 years from now, 15 years from now, we'll it'll take that long, I think, before we figure out how to put all those people in history. I mean, Trump has his own unique place, but it's interesting all the collaborators and what they mean and what they don't, you know what I mean? It's the reactionary idea of they're all part of this terrible thing is there, but time will tell us, I think, who they really are.
Maybe. I've just been obsessed, for whatever reason, with, it's part of Napoleon's account. He dictated to all of these people on St. Helena, among them Las Casas, and his attempts to figure out what is history. And of course, when it's Napoleon trying to figure out what is history, someone who was so intimately connected with making history, it's really endlessly, to me, endlessly fascinating. And Napoleon tells us in this one remarkable passage in Las Casas' journals that he himself can't figure it out. We all think that we have some privileged access to our own motivation of why we do the things that we do. After all, my brain is inside of my skull. I have privileged access to it, presumably. But do I really know why I do what I do? I don't know. I don't think so.
Almost more so the other way.
It might be more so the other way. Others might have a better purchase on who I am than I do.
So is Elsa, after all of this, a reflection of another you that might have been?
Elsa's pretty much in keeping with everything else I've done. I'm surprised when people say, well, this is such a departure from other films that I've made. It's very much like Fast Cheap in many ways. Certainly there are elements of Gates of Heaven in this movie. It's an elegy. Fast Cheap was very much an elegy. The feeling that the world is changing rapidly and that we may not be part of that new world, we may be excluded. Particularly with the topiary gardener in Fast Cheap, the knowledge that he doesn't know what's going to happen next. He doesn't know whether this whole estate where he's worked his entire life is just simply going to cease to exist along with the topiary animals. There's a feeling of everything changing, of everything passing, but the nobility of work, the nobility of going on with it all, is what I like the most about this movie, that it all may be transient, it all may just vanish, poof, but there is love, there's friendship, and maybe that's what counts. Maybe that's what counts in the end. I know that I'm very grateful to have her as a friend. Both her and Harvey have been fabulous friends. I like that moment in the movie where she's thinking about Ginsberg and what Ginsberg gave her. And she says the gift of friendship. It's surprising, unexpected. It's so much the essence of Elsa. But you realize that that is a gift. It's an amazing gift. And she has certainly given me that gift, and I am appreciative. Mm-hmm. I've never made a movie that has given me and has given my subject so much pleasure. Seriously, to watch Elsa watching this movie in a theater is an amazing experience. It really is.
Well, watching her on screen, you can imagine her taking pleasure from it.
Yes.
You can see this is a person who takes pleasure in life and is alive in that way.
Yes.
Which is beautiful.
So, am I glad I made it? You betcha. Yeah.
And you seem to be, you're at advanced age, over 50, certainly. You seem to be busier than ever. Is that the case?
Yes.
And is that just kismet or timing, or do you love being busy? And
I want to make movies. I want to keep at it. You know, what else am I going to do with myself?
So, is it doing the series been fun? You're doing a Netflix series, I gather.
It's been fun. Fun is an odd concept. I'm not sure I understand the meaning of fun. Years ago, the first interview I ever did, I was in Berkeley. I was a graduate student at the University of California. And I'd read an article about a woman, Silma Silva, S-I-L-V-A, who was a police secretary in South San Francisco and a member of the American Nazi Party. So I interviewed her, and during the course of the interview, I said, well, Selma, I know you're really busy. Your work as a police secretary, and of course, your activities as a member of the American Nazi Party. It's very time-consuming, labor-intensive. And I then asked, but Selma, what do you do for fun? And she looked at me and said, everything connected with the Nazi Party is fun. So when anybody asked me about fun, was it fun? I think, well, I think of Selma and the American Nazi Party.
So it's fun like the Nazis?
It was fun. Yes, it was.
Well, where were you will you be happy when it's done? Is the process of doing it that's the ultimate pleasure for you, or where do you get your jollies?
Mostly. I don't get my jollies. Do I have any jollies? I get my jollies from working.
So the doing, actually.
It's the actual doing. There's a passage I always liked in Superman 1 where Superman is talking to Lex Luthor, Gene Hackman, and saying, do you really get pleasure from planning the deaths of millions of people? And Lex Luthor looks hurt and a little disappointed in Superman and says, no, I don't get pleasure in planning the deaths of millions of people. I get pleasure in causing the deaths of millions of people. Superman, you idiot.
You fool.
You fool.
So you're getting your so will you... So is your pleasure have happened before this series comes out? Will we have already had
it's the pleasure of making something, which is indeed pleasurable. The pleasure of shooting, the pleasure of editing, the pleasure of worrying about whether it's any good. All of that. But once it's done, you just go on and you make something else.
So you don't linger on whether it was any good or...
No, I assume it might not be so good, and I better try harder the next time.
So every time, no matter what it is.
That's right.
Friend or foe, hit or miss.
Yeah.
You're just going to still hitting, trying to get better.
I am.
And do you feel like you've gotten better? Do you feel like you're a better filmmaker now than you were 10 years ago or 15 years ago?
I'm a more knowledgeable filmmaker now. You know, I know this technique and that technique. Am I a better filmmaker? I probably am a better filmmaker. I'll admit it. But I could still get a lot better. Mm. It's been a pleasure directing actors. Half of my Netflix series is drama. Mm. And an enormous pleasure. You know, I can show people, yes, I can direct actors, and actors like being directed by me, and I'd like to do it again. I'm interested in not abandoning nonfiction because it's too much part of me, but figuring out new ways to tell nonfiction stories. And if they involve using actors and script, fine. It should be possible to make something that has elements of everything thrown into some gigantic stew.
Well, I think that's why Scorsese is still beloved and respected the way he is because he's still, you know, in his 70s, changing what he does every film. There's always something new. There's always something fresh.
It's true enough.
And you're going down that same path.
I hope so.
We'll be the judge of that.
Yes,
indeed. Or we won't. Do you care whether we're the judge of that?
Of course I care. Do I care what people think about me and my work? Of course I care.
Does it stick with you for long, or do you kind of slough it off after a while and go on and...
It depends. Some of the meaner stuff always sticks with you.
Mm. What's the meanest thing anybody ever said about you?
Well, they've said so many mean things over the years. Mm. I remember when Gates of Heaven showed at the Berlin Film Festival, and Douglas Sirk was there. And Douglas Sirk is one of my heroes. One of the great filmmakers of the 50s. Mm-hmm. Masterpiece after masterpiece. And then he gave up filmmaking at the height of his career. Mm-hmm. He made this immensely successful movie, Imitation of Life, and then stopped. So I wanted to show him Gates of Heaven. And he agreed to come to a screening, and he got up in the middle of it, which really distressed me. And he said, this isn't a movie, it's a slideshow. So that was...
It sticks with you.
Somewhat disappointing.
And so does the love that people have for that movie since, and Roger and Gene show and everything else, make up for that at all? Or does it just, one is happy and one is sad? And...
It's somewhat compensatory, but there's still that remark coupled with all of the nice things that Roger and Gene said. After all, Roger picked Gates of Heaven as one of the 10 best movies ever made. And whether it's true or not, it's a nice thing to hear.
I'm pretty sure he'd love the B-side to that.
I think he would. I think this is a kind of Roger Ebert movie.
Very much so.
So I wish he was around. I miss him.
Yeah.
All the time.
It is weird. I miss him. It's funny. I miss him in the current loss, and then I also miss the talking Roger. It's like there's the period in the middle, and it's like there were just different lives of Roger. It's kind of, I only knew him for the last 12, 13 years of his life, but it is a fascinating thing.
We were watching The Manchurian Candidate, and The Manchurian Candidate figures in my current Netflix project. I've watched it a good number of times over the years. And there's a scene, this very strange scene with Janet Leigh and they're out in this compartment between train cars. The train is moving. Janet Leigh, Frank Sinatra. And they're having this discussion, which is insane. It makes no sense. It really doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And my wife got the feeling, I had a very similar feeling, that Janet Leigh was in on this whole conspiracy, that she was part of this whole dark deal. Was that there? Is it just something that I thought was there? Has anyone else written about it? Am I imagining things? So I looked around on the internet to see if I could find anything. And there was nothing except for one critic had written about that particular scene in detail. And that was Roger Ebert. And he saw the same thing in it that my wife and I did. And I miss him. I really missed him. He was terrific.
Well, thank you for your time, as always.
Well, good thank to see you, you for your time.
Pleasure.
Yeah. I hope you got something useful here.
Always useful.
Yeah.